Welcome to Pennsylvania's number one community college for two consecutive rankings. My name is Nick Neupower. I'm the proud president of this wonderful institution, and we're so happy that you're here this evening for such an important event. We take our role as the community's college very seriously here at BC3. And this evening's event is proof of how serious we take it. I'm honored that our college is working with community leaders to tackle the opiate initiative. I'm also proud of our role as educator and convener, something that we have been stressing over the last several months. Now, if you'd allow me, I'd like to make some comments on that video that we just watched. It really speaks to what we offer here at BC3. That was written and produced by the Rho Phi chapter, our honorary society here that we have at BC3 of Phi Theta Kappa. That video has enabled our Rho Phi chapter to have a 5-star rating. This is an international honor society, so that's a significant accomplishment. And from my role as president, I'm so pleased that we have the students who are aligned with our strategic plan that focuses on our role in the communities and specifically with this opiate initiative. Now at BC3, when we host an event like this, we have all hands on deck, individuals who will dedicate themselves to pulling off such a wonderful event. And you have a flyer that speaks to the different groups, the individuals, and our advisory team that helps us with this initiative. But I would really be remiss if I did not mention our inspirational leader in this initiative, and that's Tracy Hack. Tracy has done a phenomenal job, and if you join me in giving her a round of applause. Tracy, thank you. Now, I have been asked to introduce a couple of individuals who will spend just a couple minutes each going over their stories. So I'll introduce them all at the same time here. They'll come out one at a time. I'll sit here, and whenever they're done, I'll introduce our featured speaker. Shannon Geiser is an addiction therapist at Quantum Revolution Counseling. After Shannon, Sean Burnick, a patient currently working with Steve Troy in his Hope is Dope recovery program. Shannon?
Hello, everybody. My name is Shannon Geiser. I am a licensed professional counselor, a certified addiction counselor, a certified co-occurring disorder counselor, and a nationally certified counselor. On top of all of that, I am also a recovering IV heroin addict. I struggled for about 5 years in my addiction. I have tried inpatient rehabs, IOPs, partials, and they never seemed to work for me. They would clean me up and send me home to the same people, places, and things, and I would do the same thing I always did. In 2002, I walked into Steve Troy's life, and he saved mine. I decided to try the methadone route because we did not have Suboxone in my day. Although a lot of people said, you don't want to do this, Shannon, I decided, yes, this is the route I'm going to go. And what I found was, through using the medication, I was able to fix my life while living my life. At a lot of treatment centers I had been to previously, they tended to focus a lot on what I'm not allowed to do, who I'm not allowed to talk to, where I'm not allowed to go. And as an addict, I tend to be defiant, so I didn't like that. Steve's approach was different. We focused on, well, what can you do, Shannon? What do you want to do with life? Well, wow, I never thought of this before. I got some opportunities now. And it really motivated me to do what I needed to do to get clean and stay clean. I made a bunch of small changes over time where now, in 2018, I don't even think of IV heroin usage. My life is so different. I have a beautiful husband, two beautiful children, and his approach really did save my life. So that's all I got.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name's Sean. Thank you all for having me this evening and giving me the opportunity to speak with you. When I was first introduced to the Hope is Dope program, I was beat down, broken, and my 9 lives were just about run out. I was so close to death, my addiction to heroin had brought me to a point of spiritual, physical, and emotional bankruptcy. I had been referred to the Hope is Dope program and was basically only meeting with them to humor my poor mother. I had walked into the place thinking I knew everything there was to know about my addiction. Within 5 minutes of talking to my new counselor, Steve, I had already begun to develop a newfound optimism. Hope is Dope wasn't just offering me guidelines and suggestions. The program was offering me much-needed answers and a much-needed solution to my problem. The program was also simple. 2 key words I took from it were medication and endorphins. I'll admit at this time I was very skeptical about the medication aspect. Suboxone did and still does carry a stigma behind the name. And before Hope is Dope, I had generally been led to believe that it was something I needed to stay away from. I also didn't have much else to lose at this point. And after doing some research on the subject, I learned that Suboxone, along with proper treatment, has a significantly higher rate of success than treatment without it. I began to see a drastic positive change in my life within the first month of the program. The medication was keeping my mind at ease, affording me the ability to engage in my recovery. I began reconnecting with friends and family, I started exercising, and I got a job, which I hadn't had in 2 years. To feel like a human being again, one that contributes to society, is one of the greatest joys of getting clean. I'm going on 2 years without heroin, and I'm proud to say my life has made a 180. I'm working for my family's business, I'm a volunteer firefighter, and I'm on my way to making it a career. I'm trusted by my family again, and I'm a proud father of a beautiful baby boy named Keegan. And the best part is, he never needs to see me in like the state I was in. I'm a dad he can be proud of. All of these things I never thought possible. Don't get me wrong, life is still life with its ups and its downs, but my worst day clean is better than my best day using. It all started with a little hope. Thank you.
Wow. So as an old speech professor, 2 A-pluses. Great job, guys. Congratulations. Boy, it gives me great pride to introduce our featured speaker. And as I'll tell you in a little bit here, it had been about 2 decades since I had last talked and did some things with Steve. And as I read his bio, I'll shed some light on that. Steve Troy is a licensed professional counselor at Quantum Revolution Counseling in Cranberry. He holds a bachelor's degree in psychology from Allegheny College and obtained a Master of Science degree in counseling psychology from Chatham College in Pittsburgh. Steve has been working in outpatient drug and alcohol services with dual diagnosis since 1996. He specializes in rational emotive behavior therapy, focusing on the science of happiness, emotional empowerment, and spiritual development. In addition to writing Hope is Dope, Steve is the author of New Eyes, a unifying vision of science and spirituality. Here's what Steve and I had in common. Steve was a sports reporter and I was a sports reporter. As a matter of fact, when I left the Newcastle News to go to graduate school at Clarion University, the person who replaced me and was a far better sports writer than I ever was Steve. He worked as a sports writer covering the Steelers for over 2 decades, but he left that career because he felt more at home in his office working with addicts than he did working at Heinz Field. His career in counseling is his true passion. Please provide a true BC3 welcome to Steve Troy, our featured speaker.
Thank you, Nick. I have no intention to take your current job. And thank you to Shannon and Sean, truly inspirational stories. It's why I love to do the work that I do. I see it a lot, and every day I want to see it more. Thank you also to Tracy for your tireless efforts putting this together. And for my wife, Kristen, also the president of our company. This all got started because of her 10 years ago, so thank you. And thank you for all being here. So we often call this a war on drugs, and it's not really a title that I think is very appropriate, because most cases in a war, you have two sides fighting against each other. And having been in the front lines for about 15 years, sometimes I only feel like one side is fighting. You've got the opioid army over there with Private Percocet and Vicodin and Colonel Fentanyl and Captain Oxycontin and General Heroin, and they're all lined up and they're a mighty force and they're coming after us and we're getting slaughtered, right? They're fighting a war. It sometimes feels like we're not. Feels like it's the United States Grenada conflict or something, a little skirmish. You know, you need two sides to fight against each other, and I don't think we've brought our full resources to this war. It's a war that we can win, but we need to mobilize. We need to come together. We have a secret weapon, and I want it to be not a secret anymore. I consider it the mother of all bombs. We have a secret that if we were to use it on in this opioid war, I think we would win. It's what we're going to be talking about tonight. Now, how do we engage in a war? I'm going to use another analogy. There was a man by the name of Admiral Jim Stockdale, who was a prisoner of war in Vietnam for 8 years. In the book Good to Great by Jim Collins, he interviewed him, and he asked him how he was able to survive being a prisoner of war for 8 years. And Admiral Stockdale said he knew the end of the story. He knew how this was going to end for him. He knew he was going to survive. He knew he was going to win. And he said he was going to make his time as a prisoner of war the defining moment of his life. He knew he was going to refer back to that experience again, and it was going to give him strength for the rest of his life. So he knew he was going to get out. Then he was asked by Jim Collins, well, what about the people that died? What was that about? And he said, well, they were the optimists. He said that people that are too hopeful, they died by Christmas because they thought they were going to be out soon. They were too hopeful. And so the author was like, well, that's strange. You just said you were so confident you're going to get out, but it was the optimists, the ones that were died. And if you remember Admiral Stockdale, he's the guy that ran for vice president with Ross Perot back in 1992. And he sort of scratched his head, and he's like, well, that is a bit of a paradox, isn't it? So what's the Stockdale paradox? You have to have an unwavering faith that you're going to succeed, an unwavering faith. But you still have to face the brutal facts, right? War is hell. Admiral Stockdale was a prisoner of war. He had to face the brutal facts what he was going to go through, but he had to have an unwavering faith. So this is the war we're dealing with. In America, we're great at the brutal facts in the war on opioids. Okay, we're great at it. We hear the numbers all the time, daily. We've all heard that as many people die every year as it does in the whole Vietnam War, right? I mean, every 12 days, enough people die from an overdose in this country as did in 9/11. I mean, this is an epidemic. We hear all the numbers all the time. And if you've either been through rehabs and heard the approaches usually, it's usually pretty depressing. And we hear the numbers a lot. Look to your left, look to your right. One of you might be dead within a year. And we're good at the brutal facts. We understand that. What we're not good at is the unwavering faith. Okay? What we don't do is look at this and say, this is going to be the defining experience of my life. And I've worked with all sorts of people, and when I watch people succeed, as in Sean and Shannon, although you're probably out here now, that when you have this absolute positive approach and unwavering faith that you're going to succeed, it makes all the difference. But if you're weighed down by all the negativity, then it's so much more difficult to do. So what we're going to present tonight is an opportunity to see this in a different light, an unwavering faith. The fact is that there is a pathway to success. I'm not afraid to use the word cure. We're going to talk about that at the end. There is a way to do this, and it's a very distinct, clear, logical way that I want to present to you. And then we're going to engage this war and win it. So what I have is seven different things that you've all probably heard of before in one way or another, and we're going to put it together in a way where it makes sense for you. And by the end of it, you'll see the clear, concise path where how you're going to do this. Now, there's a lot of science that goes into this in general. And if you've heard the science or if you're into the science, it gets really complicated sometimes. I love the science and it sometimes confuses me. Most of the people I've worked with, and I've worked with thousands, they're not interested in getting a PhD in science. They're interested in recovering, okay? So we're going to take a complex subject and we're going to make it simple. That's the goal. I presented this to a physician once who described this as medical imagery. You want to be able to see what's going on inside your head. You want to be able to understand it. There's not going to be a test. You don't have to get into all the details. I just want you, I want you to understand the basic idea. So I'm going to walk you through that, and I want you to understand that it's a simple pathway, and it doesn't have to be very complex. So we're going to start with the idea of a pharmacy. Everybody knows what a pharmacy is. What do you get in a pharmacy? Medicines and drugs, right? What most people don't know is that your brain is a pharmacy. And your brain is a pharmacy that's loaded with all kinds of drugs. In fact, all illicit drugs only work because your brain has some form of a chemical counterpart to it. Your brain has natural marijuana in it called anandamide. Your brain has natural benzodiazepines in it called GABA or gamma aminobutyric acid. Your brain actually has natural psychedelic in it called DMT, dimethyltryptamine. Whenever you use a stimulant, cocaine or crack or the like, your brain takes the dopamine and it rockets it through the roof. Tons of dopamine. You're actually getting high on dopamine. It's not the crack or the cocaine that does it. It's your own dopamine. What makes drugs work is you have natural chemical counterparts for them already in your brain. They're already up there. Well, heroin has a natural chemical counterpart too, and most people aren't aware of it. Now, the word is endorphins, and that word is the secret weapon. That is the mother of all bombs, and it's what we have to unload in this war in order to win. Now, we're working in a field that has spent, or the country has spent about $1 trillion on this war in the last 4 decades, $1 trillion. I'm not sure we're making that much progress. One of my perspectives on this is we're spending a little too much time focusing on dopamine. That's one of the trees involved, and we're going to talk about that in a second. But the bigger one, the more important one in the opioid war, is endorphins. Dopamine is involved in every addiction, whatever you're addicted to. It doesn't just have to be drugs. It's also gambling, or if you're a fantasy football addict, right? If you're into exercise, you produce a lot of dopamine. What we're missing is, for opioids in particular, there's something that happens to your natural endorphin system. And there's the answer. We have to work these two things together. Now, here's how the pharmacy works. Your brain has about 100 billion neurons in it. 100 billion, those are brain cells, neurons. And they're packed with drugs. And these drugs are present at birth. Kids have them. A time when you would produce endorphins and dopamine, a good example would be Christmas time. Little kids are very excited at Christmas, and they're particularly happy because they're feeling a lot of love, at least you hope. Those two feelings are dopamine and endorphins. Right? It's actually a chemical cocktail that's like a speedball. My kids sometimes look like they're high on Christmas Day, right? That's what it looks like, because they're producing drugs, natural drugs, inside their own brain. If you're an athlete, if say you're a football player and you score a touchdown, that feeling, that awesome feeling, is an endorphin feeling. If you're excited before a game, that's a dopamine feeling. So these chemicals work together. And anytime you reinforce something, dopamine gets produced in a high amount. So, when you're a kid, these chemicals are flowing through your head, usually fairly easily. Unfortunately, life doesn't stay like that. We get a little bit older. Sometimes it gets harder to produce these chemicals. Stress happens. Life happens. Christmas morning doesn't feel so good anymore. And your body doesn't produce it as much as anymore. And then, sometimes for some people, tragedy happens. And they get introduced to a drug. They don't know what the drug that they're taking is actually a chemical counterpart to these endorphins. Endorphins, the word actually stands for endogenous morphine, and what happens when you do something that feels good, it gets released in the area of the brain called the synapse, and it goes into the receptor. It's like a lock and a key. When a lock goes into a key, a key goes into a lock, you can open the lock. When an endorphin goes into the receptor, you have an endorphin feeling. This word stands for endogenous morphine. Endogenous means inside the body. Morphine is an opiate. And so whenever you have a good feeling, like falling in love, that's an endorphin feeling. Your brain produces endorphins, and it fits into these receptors. And now you're in effect. It's like when a light goes on. If the body says, hey, this feels good, and you think it feels good, it then produces dopamine, and the dopamine fits into the receptor that's designed for its shape. And that's, now it's a reinforcer. Now the body says, I like this, let's do it again. When somebody takes a drug, like heroin, it just so happens that the shape of that drug inside the brain is the same shape as endorphin. And so it fits into the same receptor that the endorphin does. So what feeling does it give you? It's like Christmas morning feeling. It's like falling in love feeling. It's like scoring a touchdown feeling, all at once, times 10. And so the body gets this awesome feeling, this awesome endorphin rush. They get that feeling, but it's fake. It just because the shape of the chemicals are the same. I call this a hijacking. Whenever that chemical, like heroin or a pain pill, get inside the brain, it takes over the brain. How does it do that? How does a hijacking work? Somebody gets on a plane or gets in a car, they have a weapon, and they can tell the pilot or the driver of the car what to do. How does it happen inside your brain? When that drug gets in there, it changes the chemistry of the brain. And it changes it in such a way that you don't have control anymore. This is the key part of this. Most people think that it's a free will type of thing. You should just choose to stop using. But they don't know what's happening in the brain. What happens when somebody takes a fake endorphin is what I like. Fake endorphin, that's what heroin is. When they take that and it fits inside the brain responds. Look at my pen. By producing additional receptors. If you are eating too much food, what happens to the size of your stomach? It gets bigger. And if you keep eating too much food, it keeps growing bigger. Now, if you have a big stomach, what signal gets sent to your brain? What do you need to do? Eat more food. A person who starts to use fake endorphin called heroin, they start to produce more receptors too, to take on the additional opiate-like substance. They grow more receptors. It's called upregulation. It's like your brain is getting fat. It starts to grow more receptors. It starts to grow more signals that tell you that you need to use. And so when somebody keeps filling those receptors, here's the hijacking, it now takes over the brain because it continues to grow more receptors. That's craving, that's tolerance. I need more of this drug. And if you keep doing it because you don't know what's happening, and let's face it, if you eat too much food, you could see your belly getting bigger, right? Nobody sees this happening inside their brain. They produce more receptors, and because they produce more receptors, they have a higher tolerance, which means they want to use more. And when they do that, they create more receptors, and then they fill those. We have a problem on our hands now. Here's the hijacking. The chemistry of the brain is now telling the person what to do. The chemistry is saying, you need to use. An unfortunate side effect called hibernation. What happens with hibernation? Hibernation is when something falls asleep. What happens to the opioid addict is the endorphins fall asleep. This is the issue. This is the problem. The natural opioid inside the brain hibernates. It goes to sleep. You no longer produce it anymore. And so when somebody is trying to stop using and they have hibernating endorphins, what happens? They say, I'm going to no longer use. If they try to stop using, they take this chemical out of the receptor, and their endorphins are asleep. What feeling do they have? Big empty stomach, no food in it. They're really hungry. And what do painkillers do? They kill pain. In this situation, when somebody's trying to stop using and they have hibernating endorphins, this is withdrawal. They have such an intense pain because they have no natural painkiller in their body. They're not taking the fake stuff anymore. Now they're in pain like they've never felt before. And then people are telling them, you should just stop using. Why can't you just quit? Well, this is why it's a disease. A disease is when on the cellular level, when something changes on a cellular level, it changes and it has a predictable course of action. I can predict what's going to happen here. A person that has open receptors and they don't have their natural endorphins flowing through their system anymore is going to want to use. And this is an intense craving state that they don't know that's going on inside their head. So we call this hibernation. Like to be hopeful and optimistic. A lot of people say, I have a drug problem. I don't like to use the word drug problem. I like to say hibernating endorphin problem, okay? Because it's actually the truth. That's the issue. The drugs already caught did their damage. The challenge is to get those endorphins flowing again. So another way to describe this is a debt. How do you get into financial debt? If you spend more money than you have, you fall into financial debt. Simple enough. How do you get out of debt? Make more money and stop spending. One of the problems we have in the way we've handled this opioid epidemic is we just look on the spending side of things. We're so focused on the drug side of things that we're missing the financial, the making money side of things. When you have an endorphin debt, It's because you're not producing endorphins anymore, and you owe all these receptors. These receptors are begging to be paid. It's sort of like the bank knocking on your door saying, you owe me. If I spend $70,000 more than I have, I gotta pay that off at some point. If I create all these extra receptors, and they're in my head, and they're saying, feed me, because that's what's happening to the opioid addict, you gotta find a way to feed them. They don't go away. They want fed. You're gonna have to feed them one way or another. And there's the debt. You owe something, okay? It's not as simple as just stop using. People think if you just quit, things will get better. It doesn't happen that way. If you spent too much money and you stop spending, are you out of debt? No, you gotta pay the debt. So again, another way to think of this is an endorphin debt. People don't forget the name of the word heroin. They don't forget the name of the word oxys. They don't forget fentanyl. They remember that word. When they're using, they remember. They wake up in the morning thinking, where am I gonna find some heroin? But if they don't realize they have an endorphin debt going on, they're not gonna know what the solution is. They're gonna struggle, and they're gonna have a craving state. But when they realize what's happened is they've got a hibernating endorphin issue and there's a debt that they have to pay off, that's the issue, then now the solution is clear. I gotta make more endorphins again. That's the only answer to this. In fact, in the history of the world, anybody that's ever recovered from opioid dependence has done it, whether they knew it or not, by producing endorphins again. Now, where the medicine comes into play, I like to call it crutches. This is one of the most important things that we can do to engage in this war and win it. There's such a horrible stigma against this, terrible stigma. You've got a medicine that is amazing at saving lives. I've worked in mental health for 15 years. I think it's one of these medicines that they're coming out with are one of the best, some of the best drugs that they've ever made. And yet people get mocked. They get teased and picked on for using this, that they're weak somehow or they're substituting. It's a crutch. And guess what? Yeah, it's a crutch. If I broke my leg, what's the doctor give me? Crutches. Isn't that a fake leg? And if I came out here on crutches tonight, people would have said, hey, what happened? Are you okay? Now, what if I was doing something stupid? I mean, say I crashed my car and I broke my leg. People would say, can I get you a sandwich? You know, can I help you out? But if it's opioids and somebody tries to get on a medicine that's going to help them, they get mocked. They get told that this is a bad idea. You're substituting. Are you kidding me? It's the smartest idea ever. What medicines like methadone and buprenorphine do is they also have the same shape as endorphins and heroin. Now, I've got some chemistry here. Everybody knows the chemical composition of water, H2O, right? Everything in the world has a chemical composition. And check this out. The chemical composition of heroin is C21H23N1O5. That's 21 carbons, 23 hydrogens, 1 nitrogen, 5 oxygens. Chemical composition next to it here, C21H27N1O1, is the chemical composition of methadone. The chemical composition of heroin, this top line, is just a few atoms off of the chemical composition of methadone. It's almost the exact same chemistry. It's a total substitute. No doubt it's a crutch. Oxycontin, Vicodin, and buprenorphine are down here on the bottom. They all have carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen. In fact, Oxycontin and Vicodin are one atom difference. It's one atom difference between Oxycontin and Vicodin. Buprenorphine, at the bottom down here, has the exact same sort of chemical composition, but just a little bit different to make it a little bit different. There's something called half-life. Heroin lasts inside this receptor for about 4 hours. After 4 hours, you have to use more heroin. That's how that works. Oxycontin, same thing. But when you mess with the chemistry for whatever reason, methadone lasts in the receptor for about 24 hours. Buprenorphine lasts in the opioid receptor for about 36 to 48 hours. That's all it does. It's a crutch, no doubt. But that time is so invaluable. The medicine gets into the receptor area and it fills the exact same void that the opioids were filling. It's a total crutch, no doubt, but boy, isn't that brilliant. If you said, I shouldn't use wooden crutches, I should hobble around on this broken leg because that, you know, that makes me stronger or something, that's not very smart. But when somebody's trying to recover and they're struggling, because you can do it without, but when you're struggling, this medicine fills those receptor areas in such a magnificent way, but it only does one thing. It gives you your time back. That's critically important. If you do nothing else, and this is where we lose in this war, because it's got a bad stigma, because we don't do the other side of this, okay? It's terribly important to get stabilized. That's what medicine does. But if all you do is take a medicine and you fill those receptor areas, which takes away the craving state and gives you time back, if that's all you do, what happens when you come off the medicine? You're gonna go right back to craving, okay? Once those receptors open up again, you're gonna feel it again, and then you're gonna use again. So what is it we're supposed to be doing? Number six, jumpstart. We often think of a jumpstart as what you do to a car battery. A car battery is dead, that's what we say. But what does a car battery actually need? Jolt of energy. It's not actually dead. If it were dead, it wouldn't come back to life. It needs a jolt of energy. And if you can give a car battery a jolt of energy, it'll work again. What we need to do in opioid dependence is give our brains jolts so that the endorphins wake up again. I can either try to quit using and have these empty receptors and produce more endorphins to fill the receptors, or take a medicine to fill those receptors, which gives me more time. But if I don't wake up the endorphins again, I will not succeed. So what's a jump start? You have multiple different ways that you can wake up endorphins again. Our program is we looked at all the different ways that endorphins can be produced. We said some at the beginning, stuff like love, that actually works. But we came up with about 40 different ways in which endorphins can be produced. One of the quickest ways to do it is exercise. Exercise is a wonderful way to produce endorphins. Meditation has been shown to be incredible at producing endorphins if you get good at it. Yoga is a wonderful way to produce endorphins. Deep breathing helps produce endorphins. Laughter produces endorphins. Spirituality, I call it the motherlode of endorphins. Hope produces endorphins. Gratitude produces endorphins. Forgiveness produces endorphins. Drinking water has been shown to produce endorphins. I'm gonna get high. Tons of ways to produce endorphins. This is the only way anybody's ever healed from opioid dependence, by waking up those endorphins again. So what is it we're supposed to be doing, mother of all bombs? You have to be exercising, you have to be meditating, you have to be doing yoga, you have to be deep breathing, you have to be working on spirituality, you have to be laughing more. Now my experience when I first started working in this field, and I did all the war story stuff, did a lot. I've done thousands of groups in my life with people. I sometimes would feel the heaviness of the energy too. And now working with people, I can see how it sometimes feels a little depressing. We ended up running laughter groups in some of the places that I've worked. And guess what happens in laughter groups? People end up feeling better. Well, there's a noble idea, right? You feel better, you produce endorphins. Why do we have to walk around telling war stories? Everybody already knows the brutal facts. Everybody knows the horrible stories they've gone through. They've already experienced it. We don't need to hear it again. We need to reorient ourselves towards the positive, unwavering faith type of aspect to this, right? We have to make our experiences with each other upbeat and positive and hopeful. Hope itself is dope because hope produces endorphins. There was a study done. They took a bunch of college students, they stabbed them and created some pain. College students are willing to do that for money. And they created pain inside of them. Then they offered them a placebo. And they created the pain and they said, this placebo, this pill, they told them the pill was an opiate. And they reported they didn't have as much pain. Now, a placebo's fake, it's not really an opiate. But they thought they were taking an opiate, so they felt better. Then they gave them, they stabbed them and created some pain, and they gave them a pill that was actually an opioid blocker. And they told them that it was an opiate. Guess what they reported? They couldn't feel their hope anymore, okay? They actually felt pain. So what do opioid blockers do? They actually can take away your hope sometimes because the endorphin didn't fit into the receptor. So what they were able to determine? Hope itself is an opiate. It actually produces endorphins. And if we're not injecting each other with hope, then we're not going to succeed at this. That has to be the most important thing that we do, especially as people who care about people who are going through this. It has to be a hopeful methodology. You're not going to scare anybody into it. You're not going to tell them that you're probably going to die. It doesn't stop anybody from using. Hope actually works. In fact, it's been shown to be much more effective for many different reasons. And so we have to set up systems that are hopeful, that encourage exercise, that encourage meditation, that encourage yoga, that encourage laughter. Because that's the only thing that produces endorphins. Nothing else works. Now, there's plenty of programs out there that do this kind of stuff. But we got to link this together. We're in a community where people don't understand this. They don't understand that if we go and we set up systems where people actually are producing endorphins together, then we're going to be able to succeed. That's what we have to be doing. And we have to be using that word all the time. It's the solution. And we're not set up like that way right now. Some people are working on it, but we want to make sure that we're doing that more as a community. So there's the jump start. Just a little bit of hope can get it going. In fact, that's how I believe, Sean, you ended your little speech, right? A little bit of hope, that's how it starts, right? And so that's what we got to tell people. There's a cure. All's cure means, look it up, go Google it. Cure means a remission of symptoms. What if your symptoms go away? What if you get your stability back? What if you develop relationships in a way that they're healthy again? What if you start exercising and you feel better again and the mood changes and you feel better? Could you call that a cure? What if you don't have a craving state anymore? I call it a cure. I don't know why people are against that word. I like to tell people, yeah, there's a cure. It's inside your head. It's called endorphins. It only takes 5 seconds to get to that, right? But people don't know that this hibernating endorphin thing is happening. They don't know that. We got to stop calling it a drug problem and call it an endorphin debt. That's it. That's the answer. And it's not done any other way. So butterfly effect. There's a movie, Butterfly Effect, you might remember. Ashton Kutcher was in it. And what did he do in that movie? He went back and changed something in the past, and then the future changed as a result, okay? Well, the first 5 seconds of that movie says that if a butterfly flaps its wings in Texas, a tornado can be caused in Japan or something like that. Believe it or not, it's based upon real science. A man named Edward Lorenz back in the 50s got his hands on a computer, and he was a meteorologist. And he studied the effects of weather, and he wanted to predict weather better. So he took a bunch of weather data, and he plugged it into a computer, and then he compared the results. And he took two computers, and he had the exact same data in both computers, but one of them had a little bit more wind velocity, right? Like 50.12 miles an hour, change it to 50.13 miles an hour. And he studied these computers. And he noticed that over the first week or so, nothing changed. But he let these computers continue to run. And after 2, 3, 4 weeks, he noticed the weather started to be predicting different, or there were different patterns predicted in the weather. It became known as the butterfly effect because after a month, what was going to be a rainy day turned into a sunny day or vice versa. Okay? All because a little bit of a change in the wind. Butterfly effect. So if a butterfly flaps its wings, a tremendous change can happen down the road. A month later, things could be a lot different. This is not going to be on the test. What we have here is not a science, it's not a science issue. It is a effect. If you make a little change in your life, you might not notice a result right away, but 2, 3, 4 months down the road, tremendous things can happen. And if you get a whole army of butterflies flapping its wings together, you're going to get a much bigger effect. When we introduce hope to somebody, and when we tell them that they can succeed, and we don't focus on all the failures, and we don't talk about all the people that are dying, and we say that you can do this, and we point to the truth that it's just about endorphins, and we wake them up again because it's in your power to do that, when you do that, you can and will succeed. And then when you get people together in a room, and they're all talking that way, if you have 10 people talking about positive focus and exercise and laughing together, now we're increasing the effect, waking up the endorphins as a group. Now the little butterfly's flap of a wing has turned into a recovery. Now we have a war that we've been losing that we're going to win. See, those opioids don't have any defense to this. As soon as you start to fill your own opioid receptors with endorphins, you don't need opioids anymore. It's the only solution there is. All starts with a butterfly effect. I'm going to close with a concept that is in the book that I have, Hope is Dope. It's in the middle of the book called Entanglement. It's an Einstein concept. And what Einstein was able to determine, that energy is connected to energy from great distances apart. Okay? They actually did a study last year that they were able to get solar systems and from like 40 million light years away, they found that energy was connected between those systems somehow, and it's done instantaneously. Einstein called this spooky action at a distance. Somehow energy was able to affect energy across the side of the room. Tons of studies on this. If you're a sports fan, you see it during a team that's rallying or a team that's choking. You can see that. You can feel energy with each other all the time. Some of you can be connected to other people across the auditorium right now. It's called entanglement. Well, there's a psychological concept that's really similar to it called social contagion. And with social contagion, what happens is we affect each other's moods. They've done studies on this. We affect each other's moods all the time. Having done lots of groups in my life, when I see about five cranky people who are nodding out and they're sitting there in my room like this and they're not in a good mood and there's only one positive person that comes into the room, that's a difficult environment to be in, right? That one positive person's probably gonna get affected by those other five people. It also works in reverse. If you got five positive, uplifting people and one cranky guy comes into the room, they have an effect on them. It actually changes them one way or another. Now imagine social systems, imagine families, where you've got, say, one addict and you've got four people who are family members. And that addict who's struggling and going through all of this is feeling the energy of all the people who are disappointed and upset and angry and all that. What does that do to the addict? They feel it. It's social contagion. You get brought down by it. But what would happen if we reversed that? If we developed a methodology where we had people that were focusing on something healthy and positive? If we keep our focus on just endorphins, because that's the only word you need to remember from this, if you could keep your focus there, I like to say bitching doesn't produce endorphins, right? Anger doesn't produce endorphins. Fear doesn't, right? All the negative stuff that we do doesn't produce endorphins. What produces endorphins is hope and support and love. That's the point. Well, no wonder it's such a problem. Everybody says this is a horrible thing we're going through. That's the brutal facts. I'm not going to take that away. We know this is horrible. Well, where's the unwavering faith? You have to know that you can succeed. You can absolutely succeed by doing one thing, produce more endorphins. Every addict I work with, the whole idea is when they come into my office, what's the most important word in recovery? Endorphins, sir, you know, that kind of thing. You got to know that. You got to wake up in the morning thinking that. During the day, you have to think about, how am I going to get endorphins tonight? How am I going to get them tomorrow? Where's the endorphin man? It's inside your head, right? And the guy next to you, thanks to social contagion, if the guy next to you is producing endorphins, guess what? He's feeling a little hope, you can feel more hope. And if he's bitching about things, you're gonna feel like bitching about things. What do we have to do? Treatment professionals, administrators, physicians, doctors and lawyers and everybody that cares, family members, parents and spouses, everybody that cares, has to take a more positive approach to this. It's why we're getting slaughtered. Such a negative approach, and it's not true. There's a way out of this. And if everybody starts talking about it, the social contagion, it's going to catch fire, right? You have energy can affect each other from long distances. And if we start working on it here in Butler County, and people get more enthusiastic about positive treatment approaches, well, it might affect people in West Virginia. It might affect people in California. Social contagion works like that, too, across long distances. How do we win this war? By getting the whole country talking about endorphins. It's the answer. It's the only answer. Nothing else is going to work. You must fill those receptors again with endorphins. Simple enough. But if no one knows that, how is that going to get spread around? If nobody's positive and upbeat, how does that get spread around? The single most important thing that I've ever done as a treatment professional is believed in the person I'm sitting across from, okay? They come in, sit down in my office, and I don't go, tell me all your crappy stories. I know them already. They don't need to tell me them again. I know what they've been through. I can predict it. I've heard it thousands of times. But what they haven't heard is that they can succeed. They haven't heard there's a cure. They can make their symptoms go away, and all they have to do is go up in their own brains. That they haven't heard. And if they hear that again and again and again and again, now they become addicted to that. What's dopamine do? It reinforces something that's positive inside the body. It's involved. It's an important thing. I'm no doubt about it. But the scientific community has not been linking dopamine to endorphins. Endorphins feel good. And when you feel good, guess what? What's going to happen to the dopamine? It's going to produce some. And you're going to remember to do that again. Does anybody have to get reminded to laugh? Feels good, right? Well, we need to do that more. Exercise feels good. Do it a lot, produce more dopamine and endorphins at the same time. Now you're going to get hooked on exercise. Now we're laughing and exercising. And now we're hopeful, and if we spread it to each other, more dopamine, more endorphins, win-win, speedballs for everybody. Right? That's the idea. And if we're all talking like that, we can do that in a community. What does it look like? I say it's a two-step process. Number one, education. Right? Just say the word endorphins more often, please. Anybody? Hey, you got the answer. Now we've got, that's the mother of all bombs, right? I want to shock and awe opioid army. That's what we have to do. We got to drop an endorphin bomb on them. If you have a loved one, tell them they need to produce more endorphins again. Stop yapping about the drug side of things, okay? That's obvious already. But you say to them, I have an idea. Let's go exercising. Now, very important. I'm not trying to say drinking a little water is going to give me an actual opioid high. But it's a drop in the bucket, quite literally. Exercise isn't going to give you a heroin high either. What's going to do is fill some of those receptors and diminish your craving state. Now, my experience has been about 10% of your receptors will get filled if you exercise on a regular basis. Now, what if you are exercising and you're working on your nutrition and you're working on meditation and you're working on your spiritual development? Now you're filling a lot of these receptors up. It's not going to be the heroin high. You're not going to feel that. You're going to feel something else called joy, which is its own drug. You cannot sustain a heroin high for very long anyways, but you can sustain joy. And your body becomes a slow, steady drip of endorphins once the brain does that on a regular basis, because hope is always available to you. Sense of humor is always available to you, right? You do that, you develop a sustainable high called joy. You know what's really nice about joy? When I talk to people who have recovered, they don't have any of the crap anymore. They don't have the legals anymore. They don't have the stress. Their finances get better. Their relationships get better. It's a better high, okay? So yeah, drinking water, small little bit. But if you're broke, you'll take $5, somebody offers it to you. Drink more water. Laugh more often. I tell some of my addicts, I say, you want 5-second therapy? Watch a funny show. Eat some spicy food. Find God. There you go. All those will produce endorphins. But we have to do that on a regular basis. And we don't do that. So we pull together in a community, which I like to think of it as a safe space. As a therapist, I've worked with many people, and I stop feeling bad for people. When they come into my office, I'm always thinking in terms of, well, how are we going to orient this around so they can produce endorphins again? That's all we do. That's all we have to do. Like, you want to tell me your stories, fine, but let's get to work on the positive, productive things. There's the difference. And if we do that as a community, we can take off with it. The safe space is no judgment from me, because if they feel judgment from me, guess what they're going to feel? Social contagion. And then when someone relapses, this is the most important thing I could say to somebody when they relapse. I say, what'd you learn? Not shame, not guilt. That doesn't work. That's not effective because that stuff doesn't produce endorphins. But positive approaches do. So someone will come in. Oh, yeah, all right, you slipped up. Let's talk about that. Now, the medicine is so important because the stigma is so bad that not enough people are using it. We got to get that into hands of people that either can't afford it, hopefully make it more cost-effective, but drop the stigma because it works great. And when somebody's on a medicine, you could take the medicine, and the medicine holds on to, in this with the chemistry, it stays in the system longer such that you can produce endorphins again. And if that's what the person's doing in their recovery and they'll come off their medicine, then they'll feel just fine. So we got to encourage people, number one, to educate themselves. Number two, we have to support each other in the process. We got to not be afraid of the medicine that works great. And then we have to encourage people to work on the endorphin production side of things. So what I see as part of this initiative is having people, my job is to help work on the education side of things, but we got to link the community together. We got to get people using that word. And there's so many different resources out there that can help with this. And a lot of people know this. They're doing things like this already. But we got to talk to the places that do meditation, the exercise places, and the even nutritional places. I have a nutritionist that I was talking about who wants to be involved in what the best way to produce an endorphin diet is, okay? And so we want to get people like that involved. And if we're all talking about it and we keep talking about it, we're going to win this war. I've got nothing else.
Smiled across the room, with your light. Your image lingered on through my days and nights. Your kindness gave me hope when I had lost my way. Touch became my words when I had nothing left to say. Stay here by my side. No matter where we go, I will take your hand and never let it go. Let love lead the way. Love lead the way. When darkness fills our world, love lead the way. You ask for honesty. I will show you who I am. What I really want is to be your man. Remember our first kiss? It brought me to my knees. Our lips were like a prayer saying, won't you please, won't you please stay here by my side. No matter where we go, I will take your hand and never let it go. Let love lead the way. Love lead the way. When darkness fills our world, love lead the way. So many ways to fall or go astray. To be reborn in your arms today. Love lead the way. Remember our first kiss. Brought me to my knees. Our lips were like a prayer saying, won't you please, won't you please stay here by my side. No matter where we go, come and take my hand and never let it go. Let love lead the way. Love lead the way. When darkness fills our world, when darkness fills our world, when darkness fills our world, love lead the way.
Dark ones came stole my mind, wrapped my soul in chains. Now I live among the dead, fighting voices in my head, hoping someone hears me crying in the night and carries me away. Set me free of the chains. Finds me crying in the rain, all alone with my demons I am. Who is this man that comes my way? The dark ones shriek, they scream his name. Is this the one they say will set the captive free? Jesus, rescue me, set me free. Free!